Hello everybody, my name is Diego Jarquín and I am very honored for this distinction. I want to thank to the organizers, to the people who nominated me, and to all of you for being here today. Today I will talk about diversity in plant breeding, bias approaches. I hope you will like the talk. Thank you. First, I will talk very briefly why diversity matters in plant breeding, especially when we are developing genotypes for challenging environmental conditions. Then I will talk about two different studies that we have been working lately, sparse testing designs and procedures for genomic prediction, and sparse classification with multi-type data. At the end, we will have a few minutes for questions too. Many of the important economical traits are complex because they are affected by a large number of small gene effects. And also, they are affected by the environmental factors that these gene effects experience. In a way, the genes and environmental factors interact in many complex ways. In this case, we have in the left side a set of varieties where we have a variety that is not the best one in this set of environmental conditions, but it could be the case that under a high stress, this variety might be the only one who will make it. In a way that when we explore or consider the diversity of gene pools, we might find these cases where there are varieties that are resilient to extreme environmental conditions. So the idea is try to find these resilient genotypes that will make it under stress conditions. And for that, the conventional method will consider to observe the genotypes in fields. But since it's almost impossible to observe all of the potential genotypes, we have to use other type of methods. So nowadays, genomic selection is a very applied concept in plant breeding. So whole genomic prediction is an emerging methodology that combines genotypic and phenotypic information to calibrate models and perform predictions of phenotyped individuals using only the molecular marker. In a way that we can select genotypes based on the marker profiles only. We use the concept of genomic selection in our case to study problems related with resource allocation. What happens when we want to study the performance of genotypes across environments? So for this, I will present results based on real data sets of maize, wheat, and soybean. As we know, breeders are interested in the release of stable genotypes that outperform current elite materials in a broad set of environments. It means the genotype and environment interaction matters. So for this, it's necessary to conduct multi-environmental trials. As usually happens, the budget constraint does not allow testing all genotypes in all environments, but use a reducing number of the combinations of these genotypes in environments. So assuming the cost of testing plus across environments is the same, then the questions to consider are how many and which genotypes will be observed in different environments, whether we should consider overlapping or no overlapping sets across environments, and also how much the number of genotypes can be reduced without highly affecting the precision of the detected materials. In this presentation, I will show you results for three different crop species, two data sets for maize, three data sets for wheat, and one soybean data set. So first, I'm going to explain how we design these training and testing sets. Suppose that we have a data set with 843 genotypes, and we are interested in the performance of these genotypes in three environments, in a way that we might have to observe a total of 2,529 plots, but let's say that the budget constrictions only allows testing a total of 843 plots. So how to distribute the plots across environments? The first option will be evenly split the number plots at each environment in a way that we will have something like 281 genotypes per environment. The next question is how to select these genotypes. And we might have different ways to do it. The first is observe lines only once across environments, observe the same set of 281 lines across environments, or observe sets of lines that were tested only once in one environment, another set of lines in blue in this case observed across environments. So combinations of both type of approaches. Other options will consider a reduced number of plots to test across environments. In this case, instead of testing 281, we are testing 211 plots per environment. So, and these genotypes were observed only once across environments. And here, we keep the same testing set than before, so we can compare directly with the previous schemes. So another option will be combine overlapping and non-overlapping genotypes for a reduced number of plots. In this case, we have something similar than before. We just reduce the number of plots to observe it within environments, and we have lines that were observed only once across the environment and lines that were common across environments in blue. In all of the cases, the prediction set size is fixed, so we will have the 562 genotypes always to be predicted. Considering the example that we just discussed, systematically we tested different combinations of overlapping and overlapping sets of genotypes and different sample sizes for the model calibration. Initial training and testing sets were randomly composed 25 times. So here we have all of the combinations that we consider. In the first row, we have 281. This is the total number of genotypes to be observed within each environment. And the first, second column, we have 281/0, meaning that we have only unique genotypes observed within environments. 271/10 means that we observed 271 unique genotypes within environments, and 10 of the genotypes were common across environments. In the other other side, we have 1/280. So in this case, one genotype was unique within environments, and 280 were common across environments. So in the next row, we have 271. In that case, we reduce by 10 the total number of genotypes to be observed within each environment. And also we have the different combinations between overlapped and non-overlapped sets. So at the end, we have a total of 141 genotypes to be observed within environments. And we have exactly the same trend. 141/0, it means that all of the genotypes within this environment were unique. 131/10 means that 131 genotypes were unique and 10 were common across environments. Regarding the models that we use for conducting the predictions, we have three. Model number one includes only the main effect of the environments and the lines. Model number two considers the main effect of the markers via a kinship matrix. And model number three also considers the genotype by environment interaction via the product between covariances structures. Regarding the results, I'm going to show you first the results for the maze tester one. We have in black the results for the model that includes the main effect of the environment in lines. In blue, the model that includes also the main effect of the markers, and in orange, the model that includes the GBI interaction. So we have in the x-axis the different training compositions, and here we present results only for the largest training set, 281. And the composition in the x-axis shows how the training is being composed. So the correlation appears in the x-axis white. As you can see here, it's clear that the model that includes the GBI interaction outperformed the other two models by far. So what happened when we have different training set sizes? So here in the next plot, we have the case when we reduce the training set size by 10 by theory, and then by theory, and so on. So we are presenting only a few of the cases. As we can see here, for same combinations between training set size and composition, the GVI model always outperforms the other two models. And also, the results are slightly improved as we have more and more common genotypes across environments. And also, the predictability is not reduced that much by reducing the number of genotypes for training models, in this case by half, going from 281 to 141. So now the result for the next test set 2. So we have a similar trend where the model with the GVI interaction outperformed the other two models. And there is clear that there are some improvements by increasing the number of common genotypes across environments. So here we have the results for the weak data set 1, and we have a similar trend where the model with the GVI interaction improves the predictability to perform the other two models. And the same for the second weak data set. And finally, for the third weak data set, we observe similar trends where the GVI model outperforms the other models always. Regarding the soybean data set, we have something similar where the GVI model always was on top of the main effect models, but here is clear that as we increase the number of common genotypes across environments, there is a loss in the predictability, and also when we reduce the training set size. Also, we have particular cases like in Iowa 2012 where it's clear the advantage of using the GVI model over the other two models. So we increase the predictability around 50% with the interaction model. So in conclusion, we have the different patterns were observed for different crops and models. For maize, the predictability slightly improved with the number of common genotypes with wheat. It did not change significantly, and with soybean, it was significantly affected by the common number of genotypes. So finally, we have that the predictability depends mostly on the model's choice, with the GVI model outperforming the other models, the main effect models. The GVI produces the best results for same cases, meaning training set size and training composition, and it was also less affected by the composition of the training set. So with this, we achieve an efficient use of resources, seed availability, water, land, without affecting the precision of the prediction. Now I'm going to talk very briefly about another project, Spark Classification with Multi-Type Data. This is an effort for improve the classification of binary traits by doing the integration of multi-omics. As we know, nowadays sophisticated automated systems allow the collection of different types of data with potential applications in plant breeding. We have high throughput sequencing and high throughput phenotyping. Also, we can integrate weather data. And the idea is to improve the predictability or classification rate of traits. In our case, we are considering a binary trait. The models that we develop are linked to the concept of sparsity, where we are considering that there are a few variants that explain a large amount of variability on the traits. In this study, our goal was to develop a method that performs conventional classifiers based on machine learning or Bayesian approaches. So when we have different data types, one naive approach we might consider is to consider both data sets and treat them as the same nature and apply the conventional variable selection methods for classification. In our case, we develop a method that treats differently the different data types. For example, we are giving priority to macroscopic variables or secondary traits because we know that they might bring more information. And then we start selecting from the set of microscopy variables or molecular markers to avoid to lose important information on the secondary traits. We use a real data set of mice with 277 genotypes where the main response was present or absent of tilarine. We have a total of 20 macro variables or secondary traits, and we used four approaches. We use the raw data, or we got the residuals after fitting the model with the marker data for each one of the secondary traits. Also, we have SCAT and ElasticNet. We have total 5,000 genomic covariates for a total of 5,020 covariates. And we have 20 replicates for composing training and testing sets. So we set up the study considering 77 genotypes for testing, and we use the remaining for training. So under the one-pass method, we consider to use 120 genotypes for estimating the effects for a given decay parameter and 80 to find the optimal threshold for classification. And with machine learning techniques, we use the 200 genotypes for training. So regarding the result, we have the classification error was assessed as the ratio between the total number of genotypes classified in the wrong group and the total number of genotypes in the testing set. So the lowest classification error indicates the best models. We have in the left side the results for the machine learning techniques, both FDA, random forest, and support vector machine. And we have in the left side, the right side, the results for the new methods that we consider using raw data, SCAT, ElasticNet, and Lasso. The classification error was significantly reduced with the proposed method, and also we have the further developments should consider to integrate more omics. But in general, as we can see here, the model that we developed outperforms the conventional machine learning. This is all I have for today. Thank you so much, and I'm more than happy taking any of the questions.